Natalie Morgan. She's an operations manager for a business here in Charleston. She's a supporter of Senator Sanders. She has a question for you. Natalie, welcome.
Hi, Tom. Welcome to Charleston.
Hi, Natalie. Thank you so much.
I believe this question is really important to most of Charleston and people my age. I'm 27 years old, and I still have buying a house, getting married, and having kids ahead of me. What do you say to people my age and those who are younger who are frankly terrified of what climate change will do to this planet and our futures?
So, Natalie, thank you for asking that question. Look, I am the only person running for president who will say that climate is his or her number one priority. The only one. Go ask him. The only one. And I've said that I will declare, just so you know, Natalie, a state of emergency on climate on the first day of my presidency, and I will use the executive emergency powers of the presidency to tell companies how they can generate electricity, what kind of cars they can build on what schedule, what kind of buildings we're gonna have, how we're gonna use our public lands, how the government, which is the biggest buyer of fossil fuels in the world, is gonna move to clean energy. But let me say, I have done this, and let me say this. I did not just come to this. I have been fighting this fight for well over a decade, and I have beat oil companies when they tried to repeal good laws. I've passed laws inside and outside California, 50% clean energy by 2030. I've stopped pipelines. I stopped the last fossil fuel plant in my home state that'll ever be proposed. But I wanna make two more points.
Wait, let me ask you a question first, and then you can build on it for the points, because I don't want the point to get too far past. Contextually, you said earlier you don't want to have government running everything. You want to make sure it works in the right spaces. All right. Contrast that with, but on climate, you're going to use emergency powers as president, which I need you to explain to people where those powers come from. And you're going to tell car companies when they can make cars, and you're going to tell people how they can use their land and what businesses. How do you reconcile those two?
Easily. Let me say this. What I'm talking about is the government setting the rules of the road for corporations. I don't want to buy the car companies. I'm not talking about taking over the electricity system. I'm talking about saying, these are the rules that serve the American people. That's what the government does, Chris. We represent the American people's interest without any compromise, without any conflict, and that's what I'm doing here. We have to deal with this on a crisis basis. But the two points I wanted to make were this. People are talking a lot. I've been doing this for well over a decade. People are talking about environmental justice. The reason we've won all these fights, the reasons that I've been successful in climate, is I start with environmental justice. You want to deal with climate, people think it's a science issue. It's a human issue with a huge racial overtone. The places in this country where people can't breathe without getting asthma, can't drink the water, are black and brown communities. I've been to Flint, Michigan. I've been to Denmark, South Carolina, where you cannot drink the water. The woman who has been leading that fight, Deanna Berry, gets a death threat every day. Yes. So if you want to get climate right, start with the communities, the environmental justice communities of color as leaders. That's what I've done my whole time. And the second thing is this. This is a huge boon to the United States. We need to rebuild this country in a climate-smart way. This is 4.5 million good-paying union jobs everywhere. So when people say, oh, you know, we can't afford to do it, the answer is we will be better paid, richer, we'll grow faster at the same time that we build millions of affordable housing units, because we need to do that, rebuild roads and bridges, rebuild the grid. This is the biggest job program in American history at good wages. So when we talk about climate, if you don't think I'm right, you should start reading more stuff. I'm not kidding. Natalie's point is the truth. We don't have a choice on this, and everybody, this is a perfect example. Everybody who has a perfect plan they need to get through Congress, let me just say, Congress has never passed a climate bill, ever.
That's kind of the problem, though, isn't it? I mean, is that look, what you've been very successful at, if you guys have done your research about Mr. Steyer, is you get communities to organize and you get referenda or you get laws passed in those communities to make change, because that's the way it's supposed to happen. So if Congress won't do it. If you can't find a way to work with Congress to get it done, you say you'll rely on emergency powers. You know, it's probably what bothered lawyers like myself most about what the president has done on the southern border, is that he declared a national emergency where there was no real legal basis for one to build the wall. How do you avoid that system of abuse of power, even in the interest of a good goal?
Well, Chris, this is a state of emergency. The truth of the matter is, everyone who reads it knows this is a state of emergency, and we can't wait on climate. Look, there are a lot of problems. These corporations are having their way with us. If you look at the gun violence, the reason we have gun violence in this country is because gun manufacturers don't want us to solve gun violence. It's the truth. If you look at climate, the reason we have this climate crisis, the reason we're the only country in the world that's not part of the Paris Accord, is because oil and gas companies would rather make money for the next quarter than save the United States of America. We are in a position, this is an emergency. This is a crisis. And in fact, the president has emergency powers. There are 57 of them, and that's exactly what I'm talking about doing. So actually, this is constitutional. The abuse is when you claim a crisis, which it isn't. The point here is this. We have to do it. I'm telling you, I've spent way more than a decade on it. We can do it, and we can do it in a way that makes us more just, richer, and healthier. We have to do it. This is the time to do it. And if no one else is pushing for this, then they're not reading the science, because this is a human problem, but it's got a science basis. And Mother Nature is not interested in excuses for why our paper is going to be late.
All right, let's bring in Steven Spector. He's in business, innovation, and management in Mount Pleasant, currently undecided. Steven, welcome.
Hey, welcome. Tom, as we just heard, you claim to be pro-environment and raising significant alarm about climate change. Yet, we have been receiving so many mailings from your campaign, literally 3 to 5 times per week for months now. And canvases from your campaign have left, I can't tell you how much printed material multiple times at our front door. How do you justify this unnecessary overkill of mailings and printed material in a digital world that would certainly be much more environmentally friendly?
Well, Steven, let me say this. I think we're also bombarding you with digital material. But we have tried to use only recyclable materials. And you're asking me, really, if I can extrapolate, we really do try and use only recyclable materials. And the second thing I want to say is this. I walk the walk in my life in terms of climate, in terms of my footprint. I'm the only person in this race who never gets on a private plane to go to a meeting. Only person. That's probably the single biggest climate, you know, greenhouse gas emitter you can do anywhere in the world is fly private. The second thing you should know is this. My wife and I raise cattle, chicken, and pigs. And we're doing it in a way to try and show that actually you can sequester carbon if you do regenerative agriculture. You can actually do that in a way that takes carbon out of the atmosphere and puts it into the soil. So when someone asks me, what's my carbon footprint? I know the way that I emit carbon, but I believe on our ranch, we are sequestering many times more get greenhouse gases through what we're doing there than we're doing in everything else in our life. And so when people say to me, are you walking the walk? The answer is, I am intentionally doing every single thing, including never flying private. Go look and see how much greenhouse gas is emitted every time a plane takes off. If someone's asking me, do I live up to what I'm saying in my life? The answer is yes.